Singing Old Pale of Rabusic. 2 to 9.
Welcome to our Sabbath
Second service this Sabbath. We have a visitor. Let's welcome our visitor, Mr. and Mrs. Lemuel Blanco. Welcome to Oxford International Church. We just have one announcement for those members of nominating committee. You have your meeting at 5:30 this afternoon. To prepare ourselves for our second service, let me read Matthew 7:7. Ask and it shall be given thee, seek and you shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. As we prepare ourselves for the second service, let us earnestly ask God for the Holy Spirit as we seek His words and ask for His blessing to be poured for all of us today.
Opening song is Day by Day.
Try. Heavenly Father, God Almighty, Master Yahweh, we come before you this Sabbath morning to worship you, to raise our voices in praises to you, for you are the one who deserves all our praise. And so we give you thanks. We thank you for the opportunity for gathering us here this morning. And we pray that you cleanse us from all the iniquity, and so that the meditations of our hearts and the words of our mouths are acceptable in sight of your eyes. Thank you, and we praise you in Yeshua's name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath again, and sisters. We're so happy this Sabbath that we're all here to gather and worship the Lord and praise His name. I just want to introduce all our participants today. Our chorister, our sister Marmy and sister Lara. Our pianist is Brother Riz and Brother Seth. And our violinist is Brother Caleb, Brother Ethan, and Sister Nori. Our tithe and offering prayer will be offered to us by Sister Rihanna. Scripture reading will be read to us by Julian, Brother Julian, and our pastoral prayer by Sister Jan Erica. Before our sermon, we will hear a special number from the Oxfield Men's Choral, and after the sermon, we will hear another song from Sister Abby and Brother Yuval. They are twins, I heard. And our speaker for today is Elder John Rabusic. The program will go on as it is announced and passed in the
The purpose of this church is to lead blind people to Jesus and to provide solace, hope, and spiritual healing through God's grace. Thus, the Hope Vision Fellowship was established, where many new visitors come regularly, knowing they will be welcome and safe there. With its own church now, Hope Vision Fellowship can expand their assistance to the visually impaired in more ways. Nina knows that many visually impaired people need refuge from their everyday challenges. I want them to feel welcome and loved, she says. Most of the attendees at Hope Vision Fellowship are not Adventists, and they come because they feel safe there. The church goes beyond meeting the spiritual needs of the blind community. It also helps them meet some of their physical needs. Pat, one of the founding members, says that most of the church's members can't afford some of the basic necessities of life. Some rely on food banks, but they can't always get there, she says, while she prepares food bags for members to take home. Jesus touched the visually and hearing impaired, healing them and inviting them to follow him. He wants us to likewise invite the physically and spiritually blind and deaf to follow him. Therefore, he asks his followers to leave their comfort zone and connect with their neighbors, co-workers, friends, and others, praying with them, sharing literature, or inviting them to prayer meetings as the Spirit prompts them. But Jesus also asks his followers to return their tithe and promise, which is the regular and systematic offering, as regularly as they are financially blessed. We bring tithes and offerings to the church, God's storehouse, and we trust him to use them locally, regionally, and internationally as he sees fit. Drawing others to the feet of Jesus, he promises to abundantly supply all our needs according to his riches. As we return the tithe and promise, let us put our desires last and God first.
And certain rulers asked him, saying, "Good masters, what shall we do to inherit eternal life?" King James Version, KJV.
We know that we don't deserve your grace and your love, but still you stay in our midst, saving us from Satan's snares and forgiving us for all unrighteousness. Thank you, dear Lord, for your unconditional love and understanding towards us. We would also thank you for bringing our speaker today, Elder Jan Rabusic. May you speak through him so that every one of us will be blessed by his words, and as he speaks, may you increase as he decreases, and let his words be an inspiration and healing in our weakening spirits. Father, you know our struggles in life, whether it be in our work, schooling, family, financially, spiritually, or even mentally. Strengthen us, Lord, and help us to understand why we have to encounter all these trials. Help us to trust in you that you will rescue us from the pit of doubt and anxiety. Teach us to walk with you daily and not to run ahead of your great plans for us, because we know that your plans are way better than ours. Bless this church, dear Father. Bless every family that each of us represent. Give us the double portion of your Holy Spirit, that we may do the great commission you have expected for us, and that is to spread the good news to all generations. We pray all of these things, believing that you have already answered our prayers according to your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? I would introduce to you here in this corner for the good and the right. Stands the champion Robin White.
Greater than the great, no one will ever take his crown.
Church, and as I mentioned to some of you that I spoke to briefly, I'm actually especially happy to be with you here today because the boiler broke at Oxford Church, and it's very, very cold there, so here you actually get warm, so I don't have to wear my coat. So that's very good. There are people who believe that you can pretty much do anything in this life, whether good or bad, and you will make it to heaven in the end anyhow, because they know that scripture says God is full of compassion and gracious, long suffering and abundant in mercy and truth. So they find any excuse to do whatever they want. There are, on the other hand, people who believe, and a lot of other religions they practice, that you do make it to heaven only by doing good deeds. You have to do good deeds, or at least more good deeds, so they outweigh the bad deeds and they make it to heaven. Today, we will be looking at what it takes to enter the kingdom of heaven, and what the Bible says about actually gaining or inheriting eternal life. And in the greater, I guess, the context of salvation, we will begin by exploring three stories that we find in Epistles of Luke, and John, and the first one being Luke 10. So open the Bibles with me in Luke chapter 10, and there we have the parable of a certain lawyer, and which continues with the parable of the Good Samaritan, which we all, I mean, know so well. And so it reads from verse 25. It says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tested him, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?' So he answered and said, 'You shall love Yahweh the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said to him, 'You have answered rightly. Do this and you will live.'" So notice who is the questioner here, who is the one asking the question. He is no ordinary citizen. He is a highly educated man. It says he is the lawyer. He is a lawyer, an expert in the law. He's actually an expert in God's law, in God's commandments, judgments, precepts, statutes, and ordinances. So he understands the law inside out. There is no question. But this lawyer comes and asks the all-important question. He asks, "What shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And just instead of answering him directly, he turns it to a question. So he goes back to him with a question and he asks, "What is written in the law? What is your reading of it?" Doesn't Jesus know that the lawyer would know the answer when he is the one who actually knows the scriptures inside out? He knows because he says, "What is your reading of it? I know that you read it. What is your reading of it?" And so he answers and said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, strength, mind." In this passage specifically, Jesus quotes the Old Testament and he quotes Deuteronomy 6 verse 5, which is to every Jew known as Shema. They recite it 3 times a day. So he knows the answer, and this is to love God. And he then also says, which is the other bit, which is, "And love your neighbor as yourself." And so love the God, love your neighbor, these two, they encompass the whole Ten Commandments. And Jesus in Matthew 22:40, he himself says, "On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophet." And that's why Jesus then tells him, "You have answered rightly. You are straight on, you're bang on. You know the answer. I knew you would know the answer, and you know the answer. Do this, and you will live." And so if the story ended here, the formula would be quite straightforward for the salvation. Do the commandments, you will be saved. But the story doesn't end here, it continues. And it says, verse 29, "But he wanted to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?'" And it says, perhaps, just to play smart or show off a bit, or as just wanting to justify himself, as Jews, they would sometimes justify themselves in front of the people, wanting to put the point across, because they were the teachers, they knew the law inside out, and they would be testing. And it says he tested him, so he wanted to justify in front of all the people. And he asked the question, "Who is then my neighbor?" And of course, Jesus, knowing and anticipating how this conversation would evolve. He then tells him this parable of the Samaritan. And so he says, a certain man went down from Jericho to from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among the thieves who stripped him of his clothes, wounded him, departed, leaving him half dead. And then he continues on saying, there came a priest, certain priest, and he saw him, but he passed by on the other side, didn't want to have anything to do with him. Then, likewise, a Levite also came by, looked, passed on, by on another side. Now, these two characters, a priest and a Levite, are specifically mentioned here because they are perceived neighbors to the injured man. But then he continues and he puts there a Samaritan. Now he puts the Samaritan there because, again, as a perceived enemy of Jews, and he draws this crazy parallel to the lawyer and those actually hearing. And he says, a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came, he saw him and he had compassion. He had compassion on this injured man. He bandaged him and do all the necessary works, and he took care of him. He took care of him. So Samaritans and Jews, we know from the history, they weren't friends. They were enemies. They would avoid each other even from the distance, and Jews, they would not go to Samaria if they could avoid it. So he puts, Jesus puts these two characters on purpose, specifically for the lawyer, not as much for the crowd who stood by, but specifically for the lawyer. The object lesson for him here is mercy, compassion, because that's the trait, that's the characteristic trait that the lawyer was missing. That's the one aspect. He kept the law, he understood what he was supposed to do, but he was missing something greater that Jesus is trying to point out. He was missing compassion and he was missing mercy. The second story we find also in Luke, and that was the scripture verse that was read from Luke 18. So let's go to Luke 18 and let's look at the second story, which is very, very similar, yet addresses slightly different. Well, addresses the same thing slightly differently. The rich young ruler, again, a story that many of you know very well. And I will read from 18 to 27, chapter 18. Young rich ruler. And he goes, now a certain ruler, so we have a ruler now, we don't have the lawyer, asked him, saying, good teacher, and I'll notice exactly the same question, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Exactly the same question. What shall I do to be saved? What shall I do to inherit eternal life? So Jesus answers. So Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but that one that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not false bear witness. Honor your father and the mother. And the same parable, the same story is recorded in Matthew 19. So if you have time, you can read and you can compare. And there he also adds, Jesus adds, and love your neighbor as yourself. So when you look at comparison to these two stories, the previous one and this one, you can see even the answer that Jesus gives is pretty much the same. He again says, keep the commandments. Love God, love your neighbor as yourself, because this is the fulfillment of the law and the prophets. But, and again, if the story finished here and here, then keep the commandments and you will be saved. But again, it doesn't finish here. And it goes into continuation, and it says, the young ruler then responds, and he said, all this I have kept from my youth. Now again, do you think that Jesus didn't know that? That he didn't keep that from his youth? He was successful. He knew into this person's heart. He knew the person's attitudes and his heart's desires. And that's why he continues now on a slightly different note, directing his answer specifically to one obstacle that was preventing him from entering eternal life. Specifically answering to his need. So the before, the lawyer, he addressed his lack of mercy, compassion. This young man, he says, you still lack one thing. Sell all that you have and distribute to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. So why would he answer to say if he didn't know the young man's desire? Where was his desire? When he heard this, he became very sorrowful because he was very rich. So it wasn't the riches that was the obstacle. It was his heart's attachment to the riches, because that's why he became sorrowful. He wouldn't give up the riches for exchange of eternal life. He wouldn't. The wealth and all the possessions that he amassed during his young years was his life's number one priority. And when Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he said, how hard it is for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God. For it is easier for a camel to go through a needle's eye than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And so, following these two stories that we have said so far, we could think for a moment and apply to our own life. What is my life like? What is my attitudes towards our brothers and sisters, but not only those that we know? What is our attitude against towards those we do not know? What is the attitudes of us towards those that the world rejects and put aside as a society that they don't want to be wanted in the society? What about our attitude towards our personal possessions? Sometimes we want to have this, sometimes we want to have this, sometimes we work really hard to achieve things, and once we achieve it, we just hang on to it no matter cost. Whatever you put in front of me, you are not worthy of me. And so he is addressing these specific personal areas of obstacles that may hinder us to entering kingdom of God. And then there is this question that they ask, they see, this is impossible what you're saying. It's literally impossible from man's perspective to do what you say. Jesus says then, he said, the things which are impossible with man are possible with God. So things like salvation, he's saying, are impossible. Of course they are impossible from man's perspective, from our own willpower to accomplish, from our own human perspective and nature, but thankfully God provided for, because where man can't, God can. He says with God it is possible. But you may say, but how? How is it possible?
when even those around me were asking, that's impossible. And we will get a clue in the third story, which is taken from John chapter 3. John chapter 3, so find with me John chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. And again, a very well-known story, and that's the discourse that he has with Nicodemus. So John 3, and we will see what Jesus has to say in this conversation. So 1 to 17, and I'll just read it all at once, and then we'll break down a little bit. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Gain eternal life. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, 'You must be born again,' or 'It is from above.' The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus answered and said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel and do not know these things? Most assuredly, I say to you, we speak what we know and testify what we have seen, and you do not receive our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended to heaven but he who came down from heaven, that is, the Son of Man, who is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." So here we have Nicodemus. Nicodemus is a Pharisee. He is the top scholar. Now forget the lawyer in the first story. This is Nicodemus. He is above. He sits in the council, advising other people, teaching them, even the teacher, the lawyers, how to interpret the law and the traditions of their fathers. He is very well versed, one of the best. Pharisees were a particular group of law observant Jews. So observance of the law was not a question. They were very careful to keep the traditions of their sages, and they would keep the law to the letter. To the letter, literally. So they would take it literally and they would keep. Now Jesus, however, if you remember, there were many instances where Jesus criticizes them for their traditions and for their legalism. And though Nicodemus doesn't explicitly ask exactly the same question as on the previous two occasions, it is clear from the text and from the discourse as they go on that a very similar, if not the same, concept was going on there between them. So, and Jesus, he doesn't response to Nicodemus saying, well, you ought to keep the commandments, obviously because this is the top man, he knows everything about commandments back to front, but instead he introduces him to an interesting concept. He is introducing him to a concept of being born again, which means, if you look into other translations or the meaning of that, from above. Being born again, or being born from above. And on many occasions, if you read through, you see that the object lesson is belief. He's saying you have to believe, you just can't do. You've got to believe. He wants him to understand that the mechanical keeping of the law, just as it says, and you do, without actually even understanding potentially why, or not believing what you do, then he says it's not as important as the belief and the spirituality of the things, connection. And so in order to enter the kingdom of heaven, one needs to be born again from above to receive, he says, God's Spirit. He says one needs to be born from water and the Spirit, who will then lead us to do God's will, and he will then lead us on his path of righteousness. And so all three stories, when we look and we compare, they actually address exactly the same thing. They address how to enter, or entering, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, and inheriting or obtaining eternal life. But he always answers according to him who asks the question. So there is not a blueprint that one asks, what shall I do? And you will always get the same answer, because every one of you in me have different obstacles, have different troubles that keep us from obtaining, and we try and do. And so he's saying, when he compares the lawyer who's missing mercy, compassion, having difficulty with his own superiority towards others, having difficulty recognizing his true neighbor, and those towards whom he was supposed to show compassion, kindness, mercy, having difficulty helping those marked by collective prejudice. The rich young ruler, his attitude towards wealth, towards possession, he was having his priorities also mixed up. His heart was set on material things of this world and was not ready to exchange them for eternal life. And Nicodemus, he was nearly ticking all the boxes. Yet Jesus introduced the more fundamental belief system to him, and that a person must be born from above, born again from above to receive the Spirit and have faith, believe in God's Son. He says that to be saved, one must believe in the Son of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believed in him should not perish, but has everlasting life. You ought to believe that. In 1 John 5:11-12, he says, and this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He says, he who has the Son has life. So this is the entry ticket to God's kingdom and eternal life. He who has the Son has life. Why? Because it was the Son who paid, as a righteous man took upon himself our guilt, and he died as our substitute on the cross. He paid the ultimate price for our sins by his innocent blood, and thus he ransomed us. He will redeem us from our sins. He took it upon himself. So if we accept him as a Savior and repent, and we ask for forgiveness, then He is willing and he will. He doesn't say that he may, he will forgive any of the sins, any of the transgression as far as we confess and we realize. Then the Spirit of God then lives in us and guides us in our daily lives, providing power and guidance to obey, which is outwardly then manifested in our actions. And it's a little bit of sort of a mouthpiece, but just what I've described is called something that we call the experience of salvation. Experience of salvation. And the experience that reaches deep into the soul comes from God. Along the factual knowledge about God and his love is insufficient. Even the devil knows that there is God and they tremble. So the knowledge itself is just one part of it, but it's insufficient. He says, only through Jesus one can experience salvation, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And Jesus himself says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And the experience of salvation has about five steps. There are repentance, confession, forgiveness, and then justification and sanctification. Now, justification and sanctification, you might have, you might not have heard. They sound like a foreign language, but I'll try to explain the way that hopefully it's understandable. Repentance, it happened at Pentecost. That the Holy Spirit, when at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit convicted the people of their need of a Savior, they asked how they should respond. They didn't even know how to respond. And so Peter, he says in Acts 2:38, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission, for the forgiveness of sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So when we realize we have sinned, then repentance is the first step of salvation. Repentance is very important in our life. To repent, it means to be truly sorry. You know, when you do something and you then regret, you feel sorry, deeply sorry, feel remorse. And then the repentant person experiences this sorrow and guilt. And recognizing the truth that he who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes then will have mercy. They then confess their sins. So confession is then closely related. If you just realize it to yourself and say, well, I've done wrong, but that's who I am, that's okay. No, that's not the case. You must feel sorry, because what it is if somebody kills someone and you say, well, he was in my way, so I just had to remove him. That's the wrong attitude. That's an attitude that God does not approve of. There is a realization, but then you confess to God. And then tell him what you have done and how sorry you have felt. Now, King David, for example, he serves as a good example of a true repentant sinner. And in Psalm 51, he pours out his heart after his sin of adultery and murder. I mean, one of the worst sins that a human being almost can do, adultery and murder. That's what King David did, but this is how he responded. I'll read Psalm 51, verses 1 to 3 or 4 and a half and 10, and this is how he responds. He writes it down. And he says, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies." So he recognizes God is merciful. And if we turn to him, and King David knew it very well, he says, "If I turn to God, then I confess truly, I will beg him for forgiveness. So according to the multitude of your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions." He says, "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." So he's confessing. "For I acknowledge my transgression." I know what I have done. I know I should have been loyal. I know I shouldn't have done that. I know I shouldn't have deceived. I know I shouldn't have killed. I know, I acknowledge it. "And my sin is ever before me. I can't get rid of it. It's on my mind. Against you," says, "against you only I have sinned, because you gave me the commandments. You told me not to do it. You told me not to do it, but I have done." And then, "So I have all done this evil in your sight." And then in verse 10 he says, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me." He says, renew, clean my heart and renew it. Just the same time when I went to you, when I realized that you, only you can save me. Give me that steadfast, that unwavering spirit back, that I will not go to the right, I will not go to the left, that I will just follow you and obey you whatever the cost. I never again want to disappoint you. That's what he said. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. And once we manifest and express this merciful feeling and ask God for forgiveness, not only he will forgive, but what he will do, he will proclaim us righteous. Something unimaginable from human perspective, but if we do something bad, something wrong, and we follow and we do all these things, he says, "I will forgive you, and I proclaim you righteous." In Ephesians 1:7, Paul says, "In him we have redemption. Through his blood, the forgiveness of sin according to his riches of his grace." And in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." So becoming or being declared righteous then is what we call the justification. Justification is something that God does for us. We have no say in it whatsoever. We just need to confess and regret, call up unto him, because it is the act by which God declares the repentant sinner righteous on the basis what Yeshua, what Jesus did on the cross, not because of us, but because of his son. He's paid the penalty, so on that behalf he proclaims us righteous. Romans 5:18-19 says, "Therefore, as through one man's offense judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act the free gift come to all men, to all men, resulting in justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many will be made righteous." So becoming righteousness is the justification that God does for us. And please notice, justification is a free gift that comes to all men, not just those elect, to all who confess and repent, call to God. We're justified freely by His grace. And many people, still they believe that they're standing before God. Depends on good or bad deeds, that they have to work, that they have to do things, and they do. I will touch upon that later. But the Bible teaches that we are saved by God's grace through faith alone. We're saved by grace through faith alone. Romans 1:17 says, "The just shall live by faith." Also Habakkuk says that. Ephesians 2:8, Paul says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." It is a gift of God. So we are not saved by our good deeds. Our salvation is a gift of God, and we receive it through faith in Yeshua, in Jesus Christ. But that doesn't mean that obedience is not needed. We are saved through faith by grace, but obedience is needed. A saved person will lead a godly life. Because genuine faith, if you believe, will produce good works. By your works, you shall know them. If you have a genuine faith in God, your works, your actions will speak for themselves. You don't need to say a word. Person will know what you believe. And the last passage I'm going to read is found in James, that will back up faith versus or end good works. Again, very well known passage. So James 2:14-20. James 2:14-20. And he says, "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, 'Depart in peace, be warmed and filled,' but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? If you tell them, 'When you go, I will pray for you,' knowing, 'Well, I can actually help you, I have all that you need,' but do not give, what does it profit? Your faith is dead. You don't actually believe. You think you believe, but you don't. And you say, 'Depart,' but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body. What does it profit? Thus, also faith, if by itself it is, if it does not have works, is dead. But someone will say, 'Well, you have faith, and I have works. Show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works.' You believe that there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. But do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead?" So faith and works, they go hand in hand. They just reveal, the words just reveal what your faith is like, what you actually believe. And so when good works then follow our faith, now this is the result of sanctification as the last point. So sanctification is basically what God does in us. So justification was what God does for us. Sanctification is that God works in us. He because we let him in. And as we grow in this sanctified life, God's Spirit comes in and He leads us, He works in us, and He will produce in us the fruit of the Spirit. He says, these are your works, almost, these are your attitudes that you are to have. We are given them. He says, the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So if somebody hates someone all the time, so I hate this, I hate that, I hate him, I hate that, where is the love that a Spirit in you is supposed to produce? If you do hate people, where is the love of God? And you say, you can come to church and you can say whatever you do, you want, but the Bible is clear. Where's the joy if you always mourn and are troubled and see all the troubles in the world and never enjoy? Because you know the path through salvation and you know what's coming. Peace. You're always worried about things. You worry that there is a war in Russia. You worry that there is a war in Middle East, in Israel. You worry that North Korea may create nuclear bombs that will destroy the whole world. Be worried that there will be hailstones coming down and they will kill you one day. You worry that the roof about your head will collapse. You worry to even go out. No, Jesus gives you peace. He says, the peace I give to you. So if you do not display, where is the Spirit in you? And we have long suffering, which is patience. But you're always impatient and always need to get things done and always on distressing ones, yourself and others. Where is the patience in you? Kindness, goodness, if you are angry or respond very quickly without even stopping by. All these characters, and they're not easy. They are not easy to get through. But once we come to naturally display these characters, these character traits, then we are assured to have the Spirit of God working in us and through us. They can be seen. And I'm saying they are not easy. Probably for young ones, you may see some of them. For middle-aged, for elder ones, hopefully you come to realization that you have changed through the life, through the experiences that God has given you. That you have learned that God has put you through even the trials and tribulations, that they made you clear, that refined you as God, so that you can, in the end, have these characters. So what to say in closing? At a first glance, we look at the question, seemingly simple question, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? With a seemingly simple answer, keep the commandments. But looking and at a deeper sort of examination and comparing the stories and the whole bigger picture brought in within the plan or another plan about the salvation, which is a personal matter, experience of salvation, that we see that there is more than meets the eye. And so it is my prayer that as you ask the same question, as I ask the same question, seeking answer from God, seeking an honest answer from God, because God gives those who seek, that God will meet us each at the point of our faith, and that He will lead us where we need to be. And so, what shall I do what shall you do to inherit eternal life? Amen.
Amen.
Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, Master Yahweh. We give you glory for great things you have done through your Son, that you have redeemed us to yourself, and we are so grateful, because without faith, without your free gift, that which you have given to us, we would be doomed. There would be no eternal life. There would be no hope. It would be just a result of this evolutionary process that a lot of people believe. But you have given us hope to be a people of hope, to be a joyful people, because you have provided for us. You have called us to yourself. But there are things which we have done wrong, and we pray that you forgive us. We come to you that when we look deep inside, that there are things we are actually shameful of doing. Only you you know them, but you have provided enough for these things. If we come to you, if we repent, if we confess our sin, and if we invite the Holy Spirit to work in us and through us, that it is Him, that it is you who changes our life and leads us. We thank you for that, for this hope, and we pray as we go through our lives that you remind us that you enter our hearts and lead us through. So in the end, when your Son comes the second time, that we all may be found together, raising up and meeting you in the clouds. So with that hope, we part this morning service, and we are grateful to you, praising you, because we know you have heard us, because of your Son who was spared all the ultimate sacrifice for us. We thank you and we praise you in Yeshua's name. Amen.